With the Obama administration giving the auto industry some tough love, today critics are asking, what about Wall Street? Former chief economist of the IMF, Simon Johnson, is among them. He contends the finance industry has effectively captured our government. The finance industry does not really manufacture anything. It moves money around. And yet, over the past decade, as bankers placed more and more value on the paper they bought, bundled, and sold, the industry's share of the U.S. economy skyrocketed and accounted for 40% of all U.S. business profits. Those profits, deserved or not, gave the financial industry enormous clout in Washington, enabling regulations to be written or not written to benefit Wall Street at your expense. If banks are not reined in, Johnson warns, quote, what we face now could in fact be worse than the Great Depression. Johnson makes the argument in the upcoming edition of The Atlantic. He is a professor at MIT's Sloan School of Management and was chief economist at the IMF in 2007-2008. Simon Johnson, welcome.
Nice to be with you.
What do you mean by worse than the Great Depression?
Well, I think there's a view out there, there's a presumption that it's not going to be so bad in terms of the fall in output, in terms of the amount of unemployment, in terms of how things last. My point is that it could easily be as bad or worse because the financial sector has got itself so massively overextended and so entrenched in terms of its political power. It's going to be very hard to break that.
You mentioned that over the past decade, and we've got a graph to illustrate what you wrote about in The Atlantic, that Wall Street rewarded itself very generously. Pay shot up more than 180% compared to the average worker, and the linkage between the financial sector and Washington became stronger. A lot of people, though, argue that what's good for Wall Street is good for Main Street.
Well, certainly we need a healthy financial sector in this country, no question about it. But the financial sector became too big. We had a meta bubble, a massive bubble. You know, we thought about housing, we thought about dot-coms. Behind all of that was this massive increase in financial services. It went too far. It's going to deflate. That's going to be painful. And then I think we can get back onto a better track.
When you look at what happened to the auto industry today, is that the sort of model that you'd like to see or that you think is inevitable with the financial industry if we're going to save ourselves here?
Yes, I do, actually. I think the government's involved. The government is committed. President Obama said there will be an auto industry in the United States going forward, but they're obviously being tough. And when you fire a CEO, you're sending a very clear message. And I think the message in particular to the auto industry is, guys, unless you get serious, you will go bankrupt. And the bankruptcy court will sort things out. So do you want to do a better deal with the government or go through bankruptcy? They'll say the same thing to finance sooner or later.
You say there are basically two ways out, two things that have to be done. First, nationalize the banks, regardless of what you call it. The government has to take it over in some fashion. And the second point, the one you just mentioned, break the oligarchy. Which one of those two, in your estimation, would be more difficult?
Well, they're both pretty difficult. I think we've already nationalized it to some degree. We already have a degree of state control. The government actually said a couple of weeks ago that Vikram Pandit, the CEO of Citigroup, will stay on. Now, that's obviously about state control when you decide who is and is not going to be the CEO. So I think it's about going to be rationalizing the way in which the state is involved and the way that government money is committed to the banks. And then breaking the oligarchy is going to be really tough because those big banks that survive are more powerful than they were before because there's fewer of them left.
I want to talk about the Wall Street-Washington corridor on that very point. Here's some of the names that have gone back and forth. Robert Rubin, who was the Treasury Secretary under the Clinton administration. Henry Paulson, the Treasury Secretary in the Bush administration, long career at Wall Street, John Snow, Alan Greenspan. And then when you look at simply the Goldman Sachs alumni, Robert Rubin, Hank Paulson, John Corzine, why do these connections, why do they get in the way of sound policy? Because the argument is, wait a second, these people know better than anybody how to keep Wall Street greased and how to keep the economy moving.
Well, obviously you need some experts. You need some people who know what's going on in the financial sector. But I think it's the degree to which we've let the top people on Wall Street become the top people in Washington and go back and forth that's a little bit unhealthy. And I hear this from a lot of people in finance. A lot of people on Wall Street working outside of these massive firms complain. They say they become too powerful and they distort the playing field away from what some people call true bankers towards these very particular kind of financial conglomerates.
And the argument being that you're making is that when you take a look at AIG or some of these others, when they say they're too big to fail, that's a problem to begin with.
It's a huge problem. Anything that's too big to fail, it becomes a problem for all of us, for the taxpayer, and for every government. Any kind of government is going to face the same problem. Anything that's too big to fail, I would suggest, is too big to exist.
Simon Johnson, who did some of these bailouts with the IMF, and a terrific piece in The Atlantic, and I recommend everybody read it if you want to understand part of the big problem in Washington and in Wall Street and why so much of this matters. And Simon, thanks so much for coming in.
My pleasure.